So, I was unable to complete my little lecture on Congress. I wanted to talk about a couple of things really quickly. There are a couple of really, really great figures in your textbook that you should look at. One of them is this rise of party polarization. It shows how Democrats and Republicans have worked together over time. And then increasingly what happened was these ideological positions of individual party members has gotten so far distant that they don't even cross lines each other anymore, really. So the Republicans are definitely more conservative or more Republican than they used to be, and Democrats are more Democrat than they used to be. Whereas historically, a Republican in the Northeast would be much more liberal than, say, for example, a Democrat in the South. And so because of these ideologies and changes and shifts, it's really hard for Congress to get the work done that it needs to do. Additionally, we've run into all sorts of problems with divided government and hostage taking, and you should look at all that stuff. Some of the issues that are really important in representation in Congress revolve around the racial, ethnic, gender, religious sort of affiliations of some of these members of Congress. And they talk about it in terms of essentialism. But when we talk about representation, we know that Congress has historically been very male and very white. And that doesn't do very well since the country hasn't been historically as much white or as much male as you know as it is now. So what we're trying to do is trying to figure out ways to get parties to elect more females, more racial ethnic groups, and that's really, really difficult because we got to identify good candidates, candidates who have to win elections, then they've got to bring those elections and electoral victories home in terms of some sort of benefits for their constituents. Now, most members of Congress are relatively well educated. Most of them are very popular, obviously enough to get elected. Most of them are lawmakers or lawyers. Or they're advanced businessmen. You don't see very many plumbers, for example. You don't see very many lower socioeconomic status individuals running for Congress. And it's very difficult. It costs money. It costs time. So mostly this is a byproduct of how it was structured, but Congress is very elite in what it does and who it represents. And when you do get a member of Congress who's female, they don't generally represent female interests as if that was their only thing that they do. They're more than just a female in Congress, or an African American in Congress, or an Hispanic in Congress. They're complex individuals, and as we elect them to represent our interests, they may look or be part of a group, but maybe they don't represent that group in that way because we're falling on stereotypes, and we call that essentialism. Rather, what we look at is substantive representation, whether or not they do the things that we're interested in. Now, I might have a lot of interest in what my representative does because they act and behave in the way that I would like them to act and behave. They do things that would be beneficial for me. That's what kind of substantive representation is. Instead of sort of symbolic representation, like I have more females, or I have more white males, or I have more whatever. Insert group, that may not actually represent my interest as much as whether or not they actually represent my interest substantively. So there are a lot of issues that revolve around Congress. I wanted to spend just this last few seconds talking about them. I would like you to review the How a Bill Becomes a Law, Topics in American Government video. There's all sorts of other resources out there to understand these things. We haven't really dug into what a committee looks like and how that system works, but it's really, really crucial because parties structure how Congress gets the work done. Congress is this framework, right, with the lower house and the upper house and how we allocate votes. We've talked in previous chapters about how political parties work and how they structure the work of Congress, how they get people elected, how they govern. Gerrymandering's part of that, part of elections, incumbency, and now we're talking about representation, how that representation happens in Congress. Each of those two bodies have different roles and responsibilities that are crucial that they do separately and independently of each other, and then they have to work together as they try to pass laws. Congress is a really important body. It's the most important in terms of the Constitution. It was given the most power right off the bat. And the founders thought that this was the place where almost all the work of the federal government would take place.